The opinions expressed on this program are those of the host or guest and should not be interpreted as statement of fact. Independent fact-checking and corrections are encouraged.
Can we get a cup of coffee in here, please?
Damn, good coffee. And hot.
Wake up, America. You've got a dog that needs walking. That's right, sunshine. Just put on a big pot of strong coffee and get ready to type your little hate mail with your opinions about kumbaya and flat earth insanity. Stand-up comedy? You want stand-up comedy? Well, we got, we've got sit-down comedy. It's
sit
time
down.
For Coffee with a Dog.
Sit-down comedy. Yeah, you're making me laugh. Ha, 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 ha. A lot to laugh about. Ha, 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 ha. I need more coffee, man. That ain't enough. Yeah, yeah, the band's fired too. Well, you know what? Might as well keep them on. Might as well keep them on staff. Good morning, folks. Or not so good morning. It is Friday, which is a good day, usually. Friday, January 26th, 2024. We are in a bad place in America. We are really on the cusp of civil war. And you're probably not paying attention. Most of us aren't paying. Oh, what's going on in football? What's going on in television? What's going on in music? What's going on in podcasting? What's going on here and there? What happened with Mark Norman at New York Comedy Club? Weird shit. Maybe we'll talk about that at some point. But the truth is, 25 states are getting ready to take shots at the federal government of the United States of America. MAGA, M-A-G-A, is really E-U-S-A, enemies of the United States of America. And let's start calling them that, E-U-S-A, E-U-S-A, because that's what they are. Now, a lot of people, northern people mostly, never imagine themselves being traitors to the United States of America. There are a lot of people in the South that wanted to fight the Civil War again. But now you see why the 13th, Section 3 of the 14th Amendment of the Constitution about insurrection was written. Because, listen, you're on that side, folks. You are on the side of the insurrectionist. You are a rebel, a traitor. You are standing up against the United States of America. For why? For one man and his desperate need to stay out of jail. You are willing. You don't even realize that you're willing. But when the shots are fired, coming to a theater near you, when those shots are fired, you're going to still find yourself on the side of EUSA, enemies of the United States of America. And there's no escaping that unless you turn back and reject the man, reject Donald Trump, because this is all about Trump. And you say, well, no, Biden wants it. Bullshit. The Republican Party and the Democratic Party both got together in a bipartisan way to pass a border security bill, or one they agree upon. We're about to pass it. And Trump said, no. Don't do that. Don't do it. We must stop that because I need that issue to keep my ass out of jail. We can't fix the border problem. So Biden doesn't want this. Biden would sign that bill. If the Republicans and Democrats got together, and they were together, they were ready to move forward with the bill. Biden would sign that bill in a heartbeat. Trump said, no, we must have a civil war. 25 Republican governors, by Trump's orders, are defying the United States government. Now, understand, the ruling that they are upset about was made by Trump's Supreme Court, the same Supreme Court that overturned Roe v. Wade. And you were all for that. And now you're all of a sudden you believe this court is against the United States. They're protecting the Constitution. We are desperately close to being at the point. And you know what? People poo-pooed the idea when I said, if Donald Trump asked you to kill me for him, I asked my friends, if Donald Trump asked you to kill me for him, would you do it? That's ridiculous. He would never do it. He's done it. He did it. It's been done. He's asked you to go to war to keep his fat, stupid ass out of jail. Now, keep in mind, I know you, how much you hate the opposition and the Democrats. The only way Joe Biden won in 2020, and Joe Biden did win in 2020, the only way he won was because people were rejecting Donald Trump. Nobody was in love with Joe Biden. Nobody still is in love with Joe Biden. The only way Joe Biden wins in 2024 is if he's running against Donald Trump. Now, Democrats really want that to be the case because, listen, Trump is his favorability within his own party. All he has left are you EUSA, formerly known as MAGA, sycophants, leeches, stupid people. That's all he's got. The sane Republicans realize, well, the ones who are not under his thumb realize that he is what's holding the Republican Party back. You got one chance at keeping America safe from a madman. All the predictions about Donald Trump becoming Hitler have become true. All of them. And this is a sad place. I know, you know, this is not what people tune in for this. We got Shavala, the brilliant political analyst. Fuck you, Mike. Really, fuck you. Don't watch. Because you're an enemy of the United States of America. You are on the side. And you go, oh, I'm not a Trumper. I'm not a Trumper. Yes, you are. You're devoted to one man. One man. Not a fucking issue. Not a party. You're devoted to one cult leader. You don't like it, get the fuck out. Seriously. We are at the point of civil war. 25 states are ready to fire shots on the United States government because of your cult leader. You are an enemy of the United States of America. That is the bottom line. And if you think that this border thing could not have been solved by a Republican and Democrat bipartisan deal, then you're just clueless. You're stupid. And I'm sorry to say that, but this is a tipping point in America. I don't know how it would work out, whether these National Guard people or who are conflicted by, they are signed up in the U.S. Army as National Guard, or mostly Army, who are loyal. They take their orders from their governor, the governor of each state. Each governor has, now 25 states have ordered the National Guard to stand up to the federal government. Unfortunately, the federal government pays their salary. So there really is a simple solution. Now, Biden is totally fucking clueless and acting like this is not Well, he's ignoring it. He's thinking it's going to go away. It's not going to go away. They are getting ready to do battle on the Texas border over razor wire, which is not necessary, especially with the bill to fund border security that both parties endorsed until Trump said, no, I need this issue. I can't go to jail. And Biden is ignoring it, hoping it will go away. It won't go away. But we have 25 governors ordering the National Guard to stand and use force against the United States government. And if you support that, you are an enemy of the United States of America, flat out. What are you going to do? You're going to take side? You're going to be a rebel? You're going to be a Confederate? You ready to take up arms against your neighbors? Because that's what he's asked you to do. It's a very dark place in America, and you can laugh about it if you're a fucking idiot. Or you can drop the fucking albatross around your neck. You want to beat Joe Biden? Drop the albatross. You want to beat Democrats? You want to have any chance of winning this thing? Because in the end, 25 states ordering their National Guard to take up arms against the United States government, they're going to lose. And it could backfire. Certainly could backfire if Biden tries to federalize the command of the National Guard. That will be seen as unconstitutional as well. But I think the best solution is just to cut pay. Nobody gets paid. All National Guard in those 25 states, anyone participating in standing up against the United States of America, no pay. Starting effective immediately. Starve them out. Anyway, GD is going to, he's vacillating. On whether to do his critical joke theory live today, but he's scared. And like, what could go wrong? What could be the worst outcome here? I mean, nothing. I mean, it doesn't work. Nobody's fucking watching anyway, nobody is really. Nobody's in a place to really understand political jokes at this point. So, you know, there's nothing to be afraid of. Just do it. That's my thing on that. Now, I'm going to try to segue into other things. Now, today we have at 10:15, Rebekah Wanic, Dr. Rebekah Wanic, who is a mindset psychologist and personal development coach. There's that word coach again. I hate fucking coach. Gotta come up with another word. Anyway, we're gonna talk about winning mindset. And, you know, this is a Sikora thing. You don't have to be a loser. You could be a winner. You just gotta change your mindset. Mindset in itself is not enough. It's just not enough. You gotta have strategy. Without strategy and a plan and an action plan and follow through, mindset. Yeah, I can think I'm going to be a winner. I can think like a winner, but without the right plan to be a winner, where does it really get you? You're just kidding yourself without the plan. What's that light flashing back there? I like that. We got a flashing light. I think I'm getting pulled over. Lastly, before I bring Gene D in, Mark Norman in New York. Well, Mark Norman, I think, is innocent. The New York Comedy Club that he was performing in, I think, has to answer a few questions here. What they did, and you probably, if you're not a connoisseur of stand-up comedy, you probably don't even know about this, but two nights ago, Norman was performing, and in the middle of his set, some dude just got up and stood next to him on stage, and another person looked, was on stage just looking at him, a little bit menacing, but he just like, what the fuck is this? And then security came and took those guys off the stage and dragged them out the door, and then Norman said, well, somebody got tased. Nobody saw somebody get tased, and it did sound like, sounded like there were shots fired. And then the manager, the show host came in and said, we're sorry for a really strange interruption, whatever she said, and they evacuated the club. Now, everybody who saw that was like, what the fuck just happened? Like, and is there any explanation? There was video of it. I'm not going to show the video. I think you can find the video. It's everywhere on social media. It's on my Facebook page. But everybody wanted to know what happened. The club put out a statement that it was a hoax, that somebody rented the club. Somebody with the handle @high_high. The only one I could find with that handle is an Asian entity with very few followers on Twitter. There's nobody with that on Instagram. So I don't know who the fuck they were talking about. But apparently, @high_high rented the club, even though Mark Norman was performing there for the public. Now, keep in mind, the whole place got evacuated. People paid for tickets. They got thrown out of a club with the club not saying anything to them until last night, when they posted something on Twitter that it was a performance thing done by High High, who had rented the club. Doesn't make any sense at all. The people involved were bad actors. It did not seem like Norman knew what was going on, but he hasn't really commented on it, and that just makes it even stranger. I think the club was really irresponsible and all that, because, Mark Norman did say that he saw the guy get tased. If that's the case, then it probably, you don't tase somebody as part of a prank. Now maybe Norman was mistaken, but that's what he said. In any event, the club is extremely irresponsible here. It could have caused a real panic, and they're not being held accountable. They're not answering any more questions than saying what they said about it, which is really fucked up. New York Comedy Club, get your shit together. Why are you allowing a prank like that to happen on a public audience that paid good money to come to patronize your club, and then you throw them out? Now, yesterday evening, they did come out and say they were going to refund people. If I were in that crowd, I wouldn't want a refund. I'd want an ounce of flesh. Anyway, GD's here now. Willie is still in bandwidth hell and probably won't be back. Maybe until Tuesday. We're expecting him back Monday, but who knows? He might be on the road. GD is here, though. Good morning, GD. You scaredy cat, you.
Good morning. Your cup feeling, are you feeling as empty as my cup? Check out the Church of Last Resort Sunday mornings.
Well,
now 15 episodes without an episode, without an incident.
Without an incident. Well, I'm hoping my cup is empty if you're going to do this. I know you have one on tape just in case you're scared.
No, I don't have one on tape. I'm going to try it. I just don't know when you want me to try it.
We have any time in between now and 10:15 when our guest gets here. But I hope my cup is empty by the time you start it, so I should have enough time to go get a fresh cup of coffee at that point. So
if you're just going to go get coffee anyway, why am I doing it live?
I won't be gone for the whole thing. I mean, usually they're like 6 minutes long.
Five minutes, 47 seconds.
It takes me about a minute and 10 seconds to get a fresh cup of coffee.
Well, okay. I got you. Yeah.
And besides, it's not just for me.
Shit. See? Sorry.
Wow.
I don't want to do that.
Yeah, well, what? It doesn't. Nobody's going to say, oh, wow, the whole fucking thing was ruined. I saw a picture I shouldn't have seen too early. Oh, yeah. My God. Hey, let me kill myself.
Yeah.
That's not going to happen.
Right now, there are four people that have just killed themselves because of that.
Well, I hope they were in Texas ready to fight the United States of America in a civil war.
I don't quite agree with calling them enemies of the United States. I prefer right now at least calling them enemas of the United States.
Yeah.
Because enemy sounds like they have power and like they're strong, and right now they're just kind of crazy. And I would not deny the National Guard their pay. I would double it, but I would double it if they go to another state. Double it if they just walk away. Double it if they go on vacation.
They're not going to do it. First of all, you know what? Half of them are going to be conflicted. Like, who do I take up arms against my own country for Donald Trump? Now, a lot of people are going to say, yes, I'll take up arms against the United States of America for Donald Trump. A lot of them will. A lot of them will be loyal to the cause. But some of them won't. And within their own ranks, there might be infighting and all that kind of stuff. But there is no doubt that the governor of Texas has ordered, you have the go ahead to fire shots on the United States. It's like Fort Sumter. Waiting for the first shot.
I don't understand how or why that there's not something in place that can remove a governor or restrain a governor from something like that. When I don't understand. I mean, I understand.
There is, yes, there is. And it's a Supreme. Now, what it comes down to is how you enforce that. The Supreme Court verified that the United States has the federal government has the authority here. The right, same Supreme Court they are completely in support of when the decision goes their way. And when this decision goes the other way, they all of a sudden the Supreme Court is a bunch of rhinos or with the Democratic Party. Democratic, even though it's got a Republican majority, three of them were appointed by Trump. All of a sudden, they are the enemy. The Supreme Court is the enemy. But the court sided with the federal government. Now it's up to Biden to do something. And if he takes the first shot, that's not good. He can't take the first shot in this. But he is going to continue to try to remove the razor wire from the Rio Grande. And Abbott is going to continue to try to put the razor wire in the Rio Grande and force a confrontation. 25 other governors, including Willie's state. So Willie's part of our enemy.
Because, so, wait a minute, which state is Willie claiming this week?
Well, I'm the state he is in now, South Dakota.
Okay.
They are with Texas, and the governor is down there on the border. Kristi Noem, she's there. She's ordered her National Guard to stand with Texas. Just, you know what? Fucking people want a civil war, and all for one man. It's not for them, because what they really want, and they're too fucking dumb to see they're being played by this fucking fat, smelly con man. What they really want is border security. You have a deal for border security. All you have to do is get out of the way. But Trump saw it coming and pressured both parties not to make the deal. Johnson.
Yeah, Johnson, not parties, but Johnson and McConnell. Yeah. So Republican leaders.
Well, McConnell is still trying to get people to support it in the Senate. McConnell is he's got a little bit of sense to him in that he's not ready for a civil war because he knows he'll lose, and he's probably looking to go into the dementia ward as soon as he's out of office anyway. So it's not about him, but I think he realizes that the Republican Party and his state would suffer tremendously in a civil war. It's a fucking mess, and people aren't taking it seriously. We're talking about, you know, what are you doing Friday night? and you're going out Saturday night, and well, what's the latest movie, and what, you know, who's in the playoffs this week? Nobody is taking it seriously, but except those people in the National Guard who are thinking, am I going to get shot at today, or am I going to fire at somebody, and am I going to be the first one to kill an American soldier on American soil for Donald Trump?
Okay, so the solution might be for Biden to get the people that are coming up through Mexico to deputize them, make them part of the federal government. That way they have federal guards already down there. And as long as they can keep the Texas National Guard out of there, they can, you know, stay in the United States.
Willie says he claims no state. Sir, those are alternative facts. I live on planet Earth. Well, the state you're in, actually not in South Dakota right now, but the state you're going back to next week, let's put it that way, your state of residence for the time being is against the United States of America. It's part of the new Confederacy. Mm. And that's not an alternative fact. That is absolutely true. Now, whether you sign up with them and you throw your allegiance with them, now you can say that you don't, and that's fine. But your state National Guard is definitely against America right now. They are getting ready for war with the United States of America. I think they will lose terribly, but it will be hard. It's a sloppy thing. It's not like there are state lines necessarily drawn like south, north and south, where everybody in a certain state, or most of the people in a certain state, were for the Confederacy. It's really door to door. Which is, again, taking up arms against your neighbor. This is what Donald Trump wants us to do. He wants us to fucking kill each other for him, to keep him out of jail.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm not sure that it's not that he wants, he just doesn't care, as long as he doesn't go to jail, and he doesn't care what he doesn't care about the results of the election, as long as he doesn't wind up in jail and broke.
Right.
And broker, because I think he may be broke on paper again. He just doesn't know it yet.
I doubt that. I highly doubt that he's broke. Because you know he's still got lots of money that comes in from Saudi Arabia and his China patent deals and all our enemies. He's making money from still, and he still has classified documents to sell.
Now the funny thing, when they released the emolument clause violations of countries that gave Trump money, the highest was China with Trump received like $7.8 million.
Right, almost $8 million.
Yeah, right. The highest was China.
Right,
and now the lowest was the country of Cyprus, which was I think $579. Imagine now, because I think membership at one of his golf clubs is like 150,000, maybe 200,000. Imagine someone paying that for access, thinking, wait a minute, Cyprus only paid $579 for access. What the fuck?
What's the matter? They need a gig. They need a gig.
There are comedians. There are actually comedians who are making more money off of a gig tonight than Cyprus paid to Trump.
Right.
I'm not one of them, but there are.
So, you know, my friends are like going to see Jackie Martling. I'm probably going with them to the screening tomorrow night. But it's like we're planning life as usual. Life is normal when it's serious. I mean, people aren't taking this serious. Yeah, says you. Yes, says me and the governor of Texas ordering his National Guard to get ready to shoot American soldiers. Yeah, that's real. That I'm not making that up. That's not part of my imagination. That's absolutely real. And 25 other states saying, their governors saying the same thing. Now, just because your governor happens to be a Republican and standing with Trump doesn't mean everybody in the National Guard for that state is on board with it. That's my point. It's like, but I do think if you cut off all their pay, the National Guard depends on that money to support their families. If you just say, effective immediately, you're on your own. It'll let the states pay for you. Texas doesn't have the money to pay for their National Guard. They don't have fucking money to pay for their own electricity. Texas would be like, well, we got no money. So you think somebody who hasn't been paid and their rent is due and there's no food on the table is going to continue to say, wait a minute, I'm going to continue to fight. I'm gonna fight the federal government. I'm gonna fight the U.S. Army without even
Congress would. I think the MAGA ones would, because you think about things like Waco, they were outgunned, they were outmatched, they had no food, and the only thing they did was just fight back because that was their cause. I think that there's some people they're. I equate the MAGA fervor with ISIS fervor. You know, I think they have the same zealousness, the same fervor, the same craziness, and they just...
It's all about Trump. It really is. They are a cult who are devoted to him. Again, Joe Biden wouldn't be president right now, except for the fact that they ran Trump again in 2020. And, Trump would lose to Biden again. The only way Joe Biden wins the next election is if he's running against Trump. Nikki Haley would smoke him. Now, I know that's not a popular opinion. Polls aren't saying that. But polls are always wrong this time of year.
No, but that does... I think that is actually highly possible. It does scare me. That does... If it was her, it would scare me.
I know you love Nikki Haley. You have a Nikki Haley T-shirt, and you love Nikki Haley. You're a big fan. But
to be honest, I thought it was Nikki Haley in the comments. When I got the shirt, I thought it was an old band shirt.
Yeah. Willie says, "Can't we all get a long neck?" He feels like he's heard that some boy. Yes, we could all get along simply if, and you know what? We all except for one guy were ready to get along. This is the problem. This is the point I'm making here. The Republican Party and the Democratic Party came together to create a bill that dealt with the border security issue. One person in America said, please stop that. I need that issue. We could all get along if we just got rid of Donald Trump the minute he's gone.
This is like a replay on steroids, because didn't this happen like back, 8 years ago, 9 years ago with the Gang of Eight with Rubio? And matter of fact, Rubio actually helped to alter the deal. And once he got kicked out, I think once he supported Trump, he turned against the very deal that he helped to author.
Right. Yes. So, you know what? We can all get along. That's the bottom line. We could get back to normalcy where people aren't at each other's throats. The only thing that is keeping us divided is one person, a fucking cult leader who has got mindless... I just hate Democrats, man. You don't know anything about the issues. You don't know anything about what the real problem is. Just trying to save the dictatorship for the Führer. Get rid of Trump. You get rid of all the most of the ugly divisiveness in America. That's as simple as that. They're not going to do it. They're diehard imbeciles who just fucking love the smell of fucking dirty diapers. Anyway, are you? Let's get off of this because it's too fucking depressing. I do expect probably will be some noise made about it this weekend. Somebody is gonna, like in Fort Sumter, somebody is gonna be itchy and just like move too fast, even without orders to fire. Nobody gave the order to fire. Why'd you fire? I was ready. And I thought they might be coming for me. And I had a gun. So I'm getting off of that. Mark Norman, you're familiar with Mark Norman. Yes, tell me.
You know. No.
Oh, my God.
I'm gathering that he's a comedian and something that happened.
He's one of the biggest stars in comedy today. And something happened. But nothing happened, according to the club. I don't blame Norman for any of this. I don't think he really, he didn't appear. Maybe I should play the fucking video. But it did not appear to understand what was really going on. He was doing what he does, Mark, comedy. He was doing his show, and this weird looking dude just came up, and he was like just standing there, like looking at him, like I'm supposed to do something. He looked like a bad actor. He definitely did. Like I know I've been told to get up on the stage, but I don't know what to do next. And he was just standing there, and Norman looked like I'm like, hey, what is this? Hey, I don't know what this is. And then he looked over, and there was another bigger person on the other side. He was like, what's going on here? And then the security guards came and dragged those two people out. And then they told Norman, come on, you got to go, like as to keep him safe. But in the meanwhile, he said, oh, somebody just got tased out there. And he was doing this, like, little trot out the door. And then security came in and said they had to evacuate the place. So the host got up on stage and made some really weird, she was stumbling, she didn't know how to explain what was going on. Everybody's got to get out. Why? They just took the two people out the door. What the fuck is this all about? And no explanation for 24 hours until the club came out and said it was all a hoax put on by the people who rented the hall. Now, why is, if it's a, people rented the hall for a private affair, why are you selling tickets and having Mark Norman there who doesn't know?
That's what I was wondering. I was like, if somebody rented the hall, why is there a comedy show there unless they rented the hall and hired Mark Norman?
Yeah. So none of it fucking makes sense at all. No. But I think New York Comedy Club has a lot to answer for here. I mean, I would never go to that club again, and I would definitely make it known to them that, you know, that's just, it's foolish, irresponsible. Somebody could have gotten hurt. Nobody did get hurt, but somebody could definitely have gotten hurt. This is yesterday. Is this it? Is this the clip? I'm going to play it just so you know what the fuck I'm talking about. Because when you see how weird it is, you'd be like, yeah, that don't make no sense at all. Is this the clip, though? No? Looks like it might be. Man, why is everything so slow on that computer? Yes? No? Maybe. Yeah, that's it. Oh, man. I'm sure you don't know about Lex Fridman had Ben Shapiro and Destiny debating on his show. And both Ben Shapiro and Destiny, which I fucking hate that Destiny nonsense. Like a guy who uses that as a handle. Destiny, oh, to
that's
me.
That's actually a guy. I was thinking that was a woman, like a stripper or something.
Right. Destiny to me is a 3-year-old girl in a pink dress with flowers in her hair.
Right, because it used to be a band, but that was Destiny's child. That wasn't even Destiny.
Right. So Destiny is a guy. He's like a 30-something... streamer who streams games and talks politics while he's streaming games. Very weird dude, but smart, just like Shapiro is smart, but they both talk at 100 miles an hour, literally. And they do that to appear more knowledgeable and smarter than they really are, because it's impossible to listen as fast as they talk.
Right.
And so they're going like doing that for an hour and 20 minutes on a podcast with Lex Fridman. Now, Lex is a very smart guy, but Lex will say, well, how do you feel about who did a better job, who better job, Trump or Biden? That would be Lex's pace. And then they go back and forth with this super fast.
So it's like an auctioneer. It's like an auctioneer versus.
So, yeah. So if you try to slow down the YouTube thing to half speed so that you could listen to the debate in like normal human Lex. It's fucking, it's pathetic. But I listened to 6 minutes and I was like, I would kill these fucking guys. I would kill both of them, Shapiro and Destiny. It's just like, I'd kill Destiny just for calling himself Destiny. But but I do feel like Destiny smoked Shapiro because Shapiro is used to debating college freshmen. And he was really stuttering and like at a loss, like he didn't know what to say. Let's see if we could do the share video file. Let's see that. Yeah, we can do this. I think we can do this, ladies and gentlemen. Movies. I could close that fucking QuickTime then. I didn't even really need to open that, did I?
Ladies and gentlemen, for those of you on 365 and do not have video, this is GD Finison with the colored commentary.
The colored commentary. Here we go. I think this is it.
Okay. All right. Uh-oh. Oh, geez. Hey, how are we? What do we got? Migrants here? Hey, what's going on? Oh, geez. Everything all right? Just want to make sure everybody's good here. What's going on? Uh-oh. Oh, boy. Hey. Anything can happen at a comedy show. That was some kind of weird swinger sex party thing. Oh god, somebody got tased. Oh boy. Oh wait, I really froze there. I went to Mitch McConnell. All right.
What the fuck?
Everybody's got their phone out taping this thing.
So much for the no recording.
Right.
Guys, everything's fine. We just had a momentary interruption. Just say, get up, get out the taping. Guys,
can we get out or what?
Have the camera.
Yeah. I'm one of the producers of the show. We just need everybody to get out. Nice and slow. Everything's fine.
Got any photos or video of what just happened?
Now, okay, that's it. All those people paid money to see Mark Norman and really didn't get to see Mark Norman were thrown out of the club with no explanation for 24 hours. And I don't know. What's your take? Do you think you saw Norman's reaction there? Do you think he was in on it if it was a hoax?
Well, see, not having seen the minutes leading up to it, I don't know if he was doing like a killer set, and so he would be upset that this happened, or if he was actually dying on stage, just like thank God it happened.
He almost never. He doesn't die on stage anymore. I mean, people who go to see him know what to expect. He's very quick. I don't think he was dying on stage. I think he was having his show. His show is what it is. But he didn't seem to understand what's going on here. And that one guy, when he jumped up on stage, he wasn't even looking at Norman. He was like looking over at the security guard. Like he looked
almost like like those episodes like on Jackass where they have like one person has like an earpiece and they're telling him what to do, and so his actions are like a little delayed because he doesn't know what to do. It's like, oh, get on stage. And okay, I'm on stage now. What? Right. And you got, I don't know. I don't know what to make of it. I just know that if I were in the audience, I'd be a little pissed.
Yeah.
If I were the comedian, I'd be pisser. And if I were,
especially if you paid for the tickets, whatever the tickets were, let's just say they're $35 for the tickets, and then the 2-drink minimum, and you've already had dinner, you've already spent $150 there, you get kicked out of the club. It would bother me, like, with no explanation, just
and
go
that's
home.
Not even counting parking, because this is New York, right? Parking is not free.
Right. And Norman hasn't come out and say anything about it. Norman's team hasn't said, you know, his management hasn't commented on it. It's all just very fucking strange. And I don't know. I think somebody owes the world an explanation about this thing. It doesn't really affect me. And listen, with the Civil War about to happen, this is stupid nonsense that matters very little in the world. But it is puzzling. It's definitely confusing and hard to imagine what the hell was going on.
Maybe we can get the same people who cleared the comedy club can get them to clear the National Guard off the border.
Well, no, it doesn't seem like they were doing a really effective job. That girl, if she was the host of the show, okay, everything's fine. She didn't seem like, because if it were staged and she was in on it, I would think she'd have her lines down a little better than that. She didn't seem to know what to say there. She was looking around like, what the fuck is this? And if it was a hoax, what's it for? Because the club claimed it was for high_high. They didn't say whether that was on Twitter or Instagram, Facebook or anything. But the only account I found is a monkey head with Asian symbols under it with 30 followers. It's like, that's not somebody who's renting out New York Comedy Club with Mark Norman on stage and putting on a prank like that. And for what purpose? Do they have a reality TV show? None of it. It's just so fucking confusing. Or the other possibility is Norman was in on it, and this is all just a huge publicity stunt, a way to get his name totally. I don't think he needs that, though, except for you. You're the only person in America who hasn't heard of Mark Norman.
Well, don't tell me he did that just for me.
He did it just for you.
That because I'm not for that. I believe that the audience is number one. You treat the audience well first. You know, right. You give the audience a good show first, and then you worry about yourself. I don't know.
Right.
If that's the case, then I'm sorry, Mr. Mark. You've lost my support.
Ian says Norman definitely was not in on it. He looked way too awkward. Well, he always looks awkward, though, Ian, doesn't he? I mean, he's got this. He's got this ADHD where he can't look people in the eye and all that kind of stuff. He's definitely a very awkward dude. And so that little trot he was doing, that's his thing. Like, that wasn't abnormal for him. I agree that I don't think he was in on it. But the fact that he looked awkward, he's not a good actor. He's a great comedian, but he's not a good actor. I don't know. I think he wasn't in. I tend to agree he wasn't in on it. I'm perplexed by the whole thing. You should have seen that look on his face. I always see that look on his face, though. He's always got that kind of weird, like, comedy thing going on. I don't know. Anyway, so that's something to distract me from all the crap that's going on politically in the world. But I don't think we're going to get any real answers to it. Somebody's going to get sued, I think.
I would think so. But then again, unless they reschedule the joke, reschedule the hoax, not Mark Norman, had to get a different comedian, but reschedule to do the hoax differently.
Money's
supposed to be.
The loss of the night and the money you spent at the night would be small claims court. The lawsuit, if it were to happen, would be undue trauma because somebody thought, oh my God, I could get shot. I could get tased. What's going on here? There's a danger situation. It traumatized me. I already have conditions, you know, whatever they're going to say right. In a legal deposition.
I'll never be able to go to another comedy club again.
Right. I'll never be able to go out. I'm so traumatized by this, I can't even go out to dinner. That kind of thing. That's what the lawsuit would be based on.
Traumatized just hearing about it. Damn it. I got to get on this lawsuit.
Right. Yeah. Class action. Let's do a class action on behalf of everybody who saw the clip, how it traumatized us all. And now I can't.
I mean, never be able to perform another comedy set and make people laugh ever again.
Maybe you should try getting a couple of friends to cooperate with this. Jump up on stage. You go, hey, what's this? What? Uh-oh.
I could find a couple of friends that will cooperate with me.
Yeah. Yeah. Before you do the critical joke theory.
Okay.
By the way.
Yes.
That book, the comedy book, the audio book, the guy actually mentions joke theory. That's the first time, other than you, I have ever heard the word joke theory put together. And he's talking about Seinfeld having his underlining joke theory. And he says it a couple of times. It's like, wow, that's really weird. I've never heard that those two words put together in that way before. So, yeah. So before we go to critical joke theory, our guest today is a mindset psychologist, and I've had lots of psychologists on, and my fear is that they're going to tell me what's wrong with me, the major underlying thing that's what's wrong with me, and then I'm going to have to work on it. And that's my it kind of keeps me up at night. Whenever I have a psychologist on the next day, I'm thinking, oh no, they're going to see through my mask. They're going to see the real me. And then they're going to give me a laundry list of homework I need to do on myself. This is what I'm thinking about today. I'm on the couch without even being on the couch already. I'm starting out on the couch. Did you do any homework and know what she's about?
I did not do any homework.
Good.
I do not know what she's about.
Good.
I have no idea.
She's about overcoming challenges and helping people reach their goals by changing their mindset, which is a very Segura type of thing. You're a loser. You don't have to be a loser. All you got to do is change your mindset. I'm all for having a positive mindset. I'm not against positive mindset. I don't think that's all you got to do. I think that's just the very first. That's like a baby step towards. Right. You got to have a plan and a strategy and success. And this is, I know, is a fucking broken record. I'm a broken record about a lot of things, but I see too often we see people like, yeah, this is. I'm thinking where I want to be, and that's all I want to. I have no idea how I'm going to get there, and I'm going to just keep throwing, like Willie says, the Gretzky thing. You miss 100% of the shots you don't take. Yeah, but Gretzky didn't ice the puck every. It wasn't behind his own goal, and every time he got the puck, shoot it. He waited till he got a high percentage chance, and he built that high percentage chance by skating one step at a time up ice, looking up ice, seeing, making adjustments, all that kind of stuff to put him in, set himself in a good position to score a goal, rather than just every time he got the puck, oh, you miss 100% of the shots you don't take, bullock. And I think a lot of people in not just in the arts, in any career, when they have their goals, that's the kind of thing they take. I get impatient. I want to get to where I want to go, and I'm just going to swing for the fences every time the puck comes my way, and end up really getting frustrated by not making progress. So mindset, yeah, you can have a positive mindset. You can think, yeah, I'm good enough to score this goal. But you got to put yourself in position to actually take a good shot, you know. Right. And I think that is to me sums up the danger in affirmation, because you get hung up on that one quote. Yeah, miss 100% of the shots you don't take. If you get hung up on that, you are going to be a ball hog. You are going to be a Reggie Miller, who every time the ball gets passed to him, he would take the shot, even if it was from 6-point range. I got the ball, I got to shoot it. That kind of mentality, it doesn't serve you towards getting to your goal. So I look forward to hearing what she has to say about that, the baby step aspect of it. But I can't help feeling like you're looking through me, you're looking for what's wrong with me, and you want to tell me, you want to give me homework to work on myself. And at this point, I feel like I've done everything I need to do. I'm just riding out the roller coaster till the guy comes and say, okay, everybody off. And like, I can go barf and die. That's my plan for life. Anyway, you want to do critical joke theory now?
Sure. Let's do it. Yeah. Let's try it.
All right. I'm taking myself out. I'm taking myself out to go refresh coffee. I'll be back as quickly as I possibly can to catch as much of this as I can. All right.
Okay.
Hello, welcome to Critical Joke Theory with your host, G.D. Fenderson, certified forensic humorist. Now with new joke technology.
Hi, I'm G.D. Fenderson, certified forensic humorist at large, but I'm losing weight. Welcome to Critical Joke Theory, episode 40. Now with new joke technology, an open caption for the humor impaired. Testimony in the trial of E. Jean Carroll versus Donald Ray Trump, seen here having a pussy-grabbing flashback, ended on Thursday afternoon. Closing arguments are set for Friday the 26th. Trump's inane arguments, however, will go on and on and on. The New Hampshire primary was held on Tuesday, and the winners were President Biden, Donald Trump, and the people who can finally stop watching political ads. The next primaries are in South Carolina. The Democratic primary is scheduled for February 3rd, and the Republican primary is scheduled for February 24th. Thoughts and prayers. Vivek Ramaswamy, Ron DeSantis, and Tim Scott have all suspended their campaigns to be the Republican candidate for president. This reminds me of a joke. A white man, a black man, and an Indian go to sell their dignity and endorse Trump for president, as if they had any dignity to begin with. After only one caucus and one primary, the RNC is considering canceling the remainder of the GOP primaries to declare Trump the presumptive nominee. Apparently, the longer Nikki Haley remains in the race and the more she gets under Trump's skin, and no one wants to see that. So, Alabama executed Kenneth Eugene Smith on Thursday for the 1988 stabbing death of a pastor's wife, Elizabeth Sennett. That's the state of Alabama, not Alabama State. The Hornets were dreadful last season and couldn't execute an end around. Smith was originally to be executed on November 17, 2022, but prison personnel botched the lethal injection attempt. This time, Smith was executed using nitrogen hypoxia. This method of killing is experimental and considered cruel and unusual for mammals. Smith's attorneys objected to this method, saying that Smith was being used as a guinea pig. Smith's last meal was steak, hash browns, and eggs, proving that he is not being treated like a guinea pig. If he were being treated as a guinea pig, he would have been fed hay and veggies. Janelle Grant, a former employee of World Wrestling Entertainment, has sued the company, its embattled founder, Vince McMahon, and its former head of talent relations, John Laurinaitis. And I don't know if I'm saying that name right, don't care. Alleging sexual assault, trafficking, and emotional abuse. McMahon denies the accusations, but is willing to settle the lawsuit in a no-holds-barred cage match. Former Trump White House advisor Peter Navarro was sentenced to 4 months in prison a Thursday for criminal contempt of Congress, with a federal judge telling him he was not a victim or a target of political persecution, as much as he may have proclaimed otherwise. Navarro was also ordered to pay a $9,500 fine. Navarro was claiming that Trump had invoked executive privilege, confusing it with executing white privilege. A nose wheel fell off a Delta Airlines Boeing 757 passenger jet and rolled away as the plane lined up for takeoff over the weekend from Atlanta's International Airport in Georgia, according to the Federal Aviation Administration. According to a preliminary FAA notice, none of the 184 passengers or six crew on board were hurt in the incident, which took place on Saturday at Hartsfield-Jackson Airport. Apparently, with all of the bad press boing has been receiving lately, the wheel just didn't want to be associated with boing and was taking an early retirement. Retirement. Okay. Donald Trump Jr., seen here demonstrating his nipple-pinching technique, told this story at a rally in Iowa. He was returning from a trip with two of his kids. He stopped at the McDonald's at the airport, and the bill for the three of them came to $49. This was his proof that inflation was too high and blamed Biden. Okay, let's pretend that Junior is telling the truth about his McDonald's bill for three coming to $49. First, what did they order? Second, he's eating at the airport. Penny candy is $12. Like, when was airport food ever cheap? Surely not under his father. So, all right. I don't have a joke for that. I don't know why he told that story and why he believes airport food would be cheaper under his father or taste any better. Japan's smart lander for investigating moon, or SLIM, safely landed on the moon, but at a bad angle. It landed in the right place, but it must have had the wrong tilt. The SLIM was powered down with 12% battery power remaining, with hopes that the sun may shine on the solar panels from the west, and at that time they can restart the lander, although chances of that are slim. The United Auto Workers have endorsed Joe Biden for president. The United Auto Workers appreciated the support that President Biden gave them during their strike, and they called Trump a scab. The scabs have formed a union to protest being associated with Donald Trump. I'm G.D. Fenderson, certified forensic humorist, now with new joke technology. Thank you for watching Critical Joke Theory. Be safe out there, and please don't feed the crazies.
Critical Joke Theory with your host, G.D. Fenderson, certified forensic humorist, now with new joke technology.
Wait, it's all over the place, this critical joke stuff. It's all over the place. Pretty good stuff there. Navarro got sentenced to 4 months, but didn't get taken into custody. Kind of reminds me a little bit of Steve Bannon, who got sentenced to 4 months 2 years ago and has not served a day yet.
Yeah, that's...
So I don't think Navarro's ever gonna serve a single day of his sentence. I don't get it. If it were me, I would have served 2 years of my 4 month sentence already.
And that's what time off with good behavior.
Right. And they would never, you know, they just throw away the key, like, forget it. But yeah, we gave you 4 months, but really it's the rest of your life. To just deal with it. It's just bizarre. What else in there was did I want to comment on? The Junior stuff. First, $49. You pay that for breakfast for one person in the airport. But he's just so out of touch with what prices should be. Just like his father, who thinks that you need your ID to buy groceries. They've never done it. Like that, you know, and when he says gas is $8 a gallon, you know what? This is so fucking bizarre that he will say that in front of a big crowd, and not one of them will say, well, I just bought gas today. I mean, I buy gas a couple of times a week. It's not $8. It's here, it's $2.90 a gallon. In New Hampshire, when he was in front of these big crowds telling him it was $8 a gallon, it was like $2.47 for regular that the day he's on stage. And not one of the people in the audience has enough, I don't know, brain power to say, he's lying to me. He's just lying to me.
my wife and I were watching a show that we had recorded. My wife and I record we watch Dexter every year. We start over and watch the series Dexter from, you know, starting in January, watch the whole thing. The episode we were watching was recorded and was aired in 2007 originally. In the background, the guy's pumping gas, and you can see the price of gas in 2007 was $3.49.
Right.
So the people are complaining. Like, first of all, gas, the price of anything does not go down over time. It always goes up. And the only exception used to be technology. Like if you bought a new television, the price used to be high in the beginning until they reached a certain point, and then they would drop the price after, you know.
I think that's still true.
Okay.
Because TVs today are cheap, like a color TV in 1963 would have cost you like $450 or something. Now you can get a bigger TV than you would have gotten in 1963 for $149 on Walmart special or Amazon special.
Yeah, but they're complaining that because last week that TV was $130.
Right. Yeah, 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 yeah.
See, what I'm saying is that people have lost their long-term perspective. That, you
right.
know, yeah. They don't. They just like, yeah. I can complain that when the first time I bought a gallon of gas, it was 25 cents.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. So that I appreciate that you did it live today. I enjoyed it more. What I obviously missed the first minute or so, but I enjoyed it more than watching the tape. And I hope the audience did. I will look later to see if we had drop off, but I don't think my gut instinct is saying no, we don't.
Well, maybe they're waiting for the train wreck.
Yeah. Well,
and I didn't get a chance to practice it. That's just it. I didn't get a chance to read. Well, I read through it once, but I like to read through it a couple of times to
right.
look for mistakes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, like but punctuation, because you go to read a word, but the punctuation isn't there, and so it changes because you don't use the comma, and it changes the way the sentence is read.
I wrote out two scripts for myself last night. One is for my last Tom Segura video, at least for the time being, my last Tom Segura video, and the other is for my Business of Pod channel. But I hate reading scripts, and even I read through them like three or four times, and I will still get tripped up on a word here or there. This is what occurred to me while I was getting my coffee about what I was talking about, home run and swinging for home runs. I do think there's a shot. Both you and Willie are in a fairly decent position to take a shot at. Jon Stewart is taking back over The Daily Show. Right. And I do think if you guys put together some material, written or video stuff that, you know, is right for The Daily Show, he definitely wants contributors all the time. He's always looking for new contributors. Not saying you'd get a steady spot on the show, but I think it's a good way for you to hit a home run from home without doing like a tremendous amount of, all you got to do is put together the material and send it in. I know for a fact they review everything that comes in as positioned as a contribution. And the kind of stuff you just did, it's definitely the kind of stuff they love. Not necessarily, you know, that kind of live read. You could do that as a you know, polished, recorded, edited script type of thing and send that in. But again, back to the home run idea, this is a shot I think you guys, people like you and Willie, are in a good position to take, and I would take it if I were you. I'm not saying you should. I'm saying if I were you, I would.
Well, if I knew, I'll just find out where to send it.
It's they're on I believe 9th Avenue, like around 48th Street or something, but I can get you the address to send it to. Basically, you just put it in a package and send snail mail and write contribution request or something like that on it. And I know they review every single one that comes in. And that is a shot worth taking. That is definitely a shot worth taking. It's a shot worth taking repeatedly. Like I would do one a week until they, I'm serious about that. I would do one a week until they responded yes or no, either way. And even
maybe
with a no, I'd probably.
Maybe the Reverend can do one.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Once a, because that way it doesn't have to be topical at the time. It could be topical over a period of time. Because critical joke theory is like every week.
Yeah. Listen, yeah.
Go ahead.
I'm going to out myself as a complete racist asshole here, but white people love the black guy in character. Like I'm thinking, like Dean Martin Rose would love the Reverend. You know what I mean? That character would be a really attractive thing. People love that. Middle America loves that because, you know, it's a fake real person.
Yeah.
Not that the Rev is fake at all, but.
I understand what you're saying. He's not fake, although he doesn't have a driver's license.
Yeah, right.
If he gets pulled over, he's in trouble. That's why when the two of us go out together, I drive.
Right.
Not that I would get in less trouble, at least I have a license.
Right. Now, the last night I put out a lot of reels. AI, first of all, let me just make it clear that AI edited the reels. I just manually posted some last night because I didn't want to wait for the scheduled postings to go out. And I was looking to get some extra traffic boost on my numbers. And one of the ones I put out was John Stage the other day was on the program. Might have been yesterday or no, 2 days ago. And we were talking about Norman's joke, and I made, because we were talking about how people tend to take comedians seriously and think their jokes are an indication of their true political leanings, or they really care about that issue when all they're trying to do is be funny. And Norman made the joke about, he made some joke about abortion, and a woman came up and said, I'm really offended about your joke about abortion. I've had an abortion. And he said, all I did was tell a joke. What you did was far worse. That reel came out, and somebody said, that's an old joke. It's stolen. It's Mark Norman's joke. And I was like, I made that very clear in the long version. AI cut me off as saying this is a Mark Norman joke, so it looks like I'm stealing his joke. So I look like the joke thief. You know what? AI has its good ups and downs to it, but that is definitely taking 30-second to 60-second clips out of context and assuming you know exactly that's all there is to it. And a lot of people do that. Like, they don't understand that this is a snippet from a two and a half hour show. It's 30 seconds from a 2.5 hour show. I can judge everything I need to know from this 30 seconds.
I spend a lot of time with nature. I love nature. I love animals. I love animals better than I like people in general. And one of the things I like about animals is it seems like they learn better than people. You know, people are just so much more stupid than animals are. You know, I'm just thinking about what made me think of it was because when I walk out my back door, birds will come from miles away. As soon as I come out the back door, you hear one bird call, the other bird call, and they all flock. And they know which tree to go to. Even though I walk out my back door, they go to my front tree because that's where I put the nuts out for the, you know, for some of the animals. You get comedians, you can give them a flyer, put their name on it, and they can't find where the fucking show is.
Right. I have a question I would like to ask. Why do birds suddenly appear every time you are near?
My nuts.
Oh, I thought just like me, they long to be close to you.
No, they're there for my nuts. They don't, and my seed. They don't care about me personally.
It surprises me how they know. Because I used to feed the birds a lot too. My father was a big time bird feeder, but you'll see no birds in the area at all. As soon as you go out and start spreading feed, like there is a memo goes out to every bird in the state. We have feral cats that yesterday there were people working on the house, construction people here. And I looked out the window and these two feral cats who've gotten used to my wife feeding them since the lady in across the street who used to feed them has been in rehab. These cats were standing there staring at the window, like looking me directly in the eye like, where's the food? We're here. Where's the food? Like they've been trained in a very short time to understand where the food lady is and just wait by the back door and she will come out. Our guest is here. I have to play a really quick commercial. One that is not good for your mindset. How about that? But it is important because I've neglected these people as sponsors for over 2 weeks and they are getting a little antsy about it. So I promised I would run one this week and then I didn't run one this week for them. So here it is.
But it's still this week.
Huh?
It's still this week. So you're running it now.
Well, yeah, right. That's why I'm running it now, because it's my last chance to make them happy. Daily High Club is proud to sponsor the Coffee with the Dog program.
Can you really make them happy? Don't they have to choose to be happy?
Yeah, it's all about mindset, man. It's all about having a positive, happy mindset. But here's the thing. If you smoke a little too much, if you patronize Daily High Club a little too much, it might mess with your mindset in a serious way. But we have to play it. So I love Daily High Club. I'm almost daily high right now. What?
With humble East Coast beginnings in 2015, Daily High Club is the premier destination for glass water pipes, vaporizers, and consumption accessories. If you're looking to elevate your smoking game to the next level, you're in the right place. With over 1 million top quality smoking products sold, and with a growing base of over 10,000 monthly subscribers worldwide, we deliver the ultimate smoking experience. But Daily High Club is not just another retailer. We're lovers of the smoking scene ourselves, working with giants like Tommy Chong, Snoop Dogg, Chanel West Coast, and more. Ready to join the Daily High Club? Let our experts curate your collection with our awesome El Primo monthly subscription box, or grab one of our fun and unique pieces from our smoke shop. Get started today. Visit MindDogTV.com and click on the banner on the homepage.
I'm a little bit muted here. What's going on? Tommy Chong is not a giant. We've had him on the show. He's a regular-sized guy. I don't think Snoop Dogg's a giant either. I think that's false advertising.
That's like having a psychic medium, because they only come in that one size as well. They don't come in larges or smalls.
Right. Our guest is Dr. Rebekah Wanic. I hope I am pronouncing her last name right. If I'm not, I'll give her full permission to slap me across the internet. She's a mindset and psychologist, and a personal development coach who works with entrepreneurs and individuals to help them overcome challenges and reach their goals in order to really take shots that do make some high percentage scoring. Welcome in, Dr. Rebekah Wanic. Good morning.
Hi, thank you so much for having me. Good morning.
It's our pleasure to have you here. Now, I just so you're aware, I made it clear, every time I have a psychologist on the program, I get nervous that they're seeing through my facade and my mask, and they're going to give me a lot of homework on how to fix what's wrong with me. And
No homework, and I'm not analyzing you. Also, I'm not a clinician. So clinicians are the ones that you have to look out for. I'm a social psychologist by training, with some specialty in the way that mindset influences how we view situations, and also obviously then how we view ourselves and some of the choices that we make.
All right. Now, mindset is a, I think it's an important element. And this is because I always talk about mindset is just really the first step. But without like a clear strategy or where you go from, you can think, well, I'm going to be successful, and you can get all these affirmations and cliches that you tell yourself about success to keep yourself in a positive frame of mind. But if you don't have a strategic action plan from there, it's all kind of useless. What's your take on that?
Yeah. So first of all, I think like, the viewing yourself from a positive light is good, but I always advocate for view yourself through the lens of critique, because if everything you were doing was good and great, then you'd already be successful. So obviously there's room for improvement. So my really core mantra is live in the space of challenge, constantly be looking at what you're doing wrong, not always celebrating what you're doing right. And you oftentimes need somebody else to help you with this, because like I have years of training of the self-critique and looking for places for improvement, but most of us live in this delusional state where we have a lot of rationalization. We tell ourselves that everything is fine when it's not, because that's self-protective. It makes us feel good in the moment. But my idea is if you feel uncomfortable in the moment, the next moment's going to be better. The next one after that is going to be even better. So you have to kind of get away from this view that the larger mental health community really reinforces a lot of disempowering messages that are like, you should strive to feel good about yourself all the time. High self-esteem is key, because it's not really going to be the thing that's going to help push you forward more optimally in the long run, if that's the space you sit in all the time.
Right. I think a lot of people become addicted to self-help, quick fixes, and get addicted to things like affirmations and stuff. And it comes off as me saying that, as people think I'm against affirmations. I'm not against affirmations. I'm against people living their lives as one string of affirmations after another, thinking that is all I need, is just to keep telling myself, move forward, move forward, move forward. You're doing the right thing. Keep on the path. Don't give up. Don't quit. All those kind of things, one after another. And at the end, if you don't have any progress to show for it, to measure your success, that is an indication that that strategy of affirmation addiction is a failure. What's your take on that?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And the thing is, so when I talk about mindset is important only if it drives a change in your behavior. Because right. Ultimately, whether you are or are not getting the things that you want, it has to do with what you're doing. The other thing that goes along with that idea of affirmations that's really problematic is we exist in this me first state of mind all the time, where it's like, I go into a space, I expect my feelings to be acknowledged, I need to be validated, everything about me matters. And I'm like, it matters to you, but that doesn't mean that it has to matter to everybody else. Whatever's going on with you, you can get people to celebrate it, but don't ask me to celebrate it, because I have every right to have a different set of standards that I can use to evaluate things. And society as a whole has a shared set of standards about things that are going to lead to success and things that are not. And if you sit there and you affirm yourself and say, my mindset is the correct way of viewing the world, and you go out into the world and the world's not responding to that, then you going back and saying, but I'm right, I know I'm right, celebrate me, is going to get you nowhere.
Right.
You have to understand that we exist as entities in a social shared space. And so learning to adjust self to situation is really a key part of having optimized mindset. What's right. happening around you? I always say, read the room, right? Like, pay attention to what's going on around you, because that's going to be the thing that's going to help you to be the most effective. And it's challenging. It's challenging to learn to accept that your feelings, your thoughts, your perception isn't always going to be the thing that's correct. So you need to find people that are going to give good, useful feedback to help push you to challenge yourself to grow and change.
Okay, it would help me if you were to stop saying things I agree with already, so that I can, so that I can say something counter. So I can't. So let's do this. Are we saying your last name correctly? And if we're not, is this the last name you're going to have that we know?
You want her to slap me across the internet?
No, I think you said Wanic. That's what it is. Correct.
Yeah, I did say that. And he's just so used to me screwing people's names up that he was hoping that you would be mean to me for screwing your name up. But
I wasn't. It's a hoping fairly that you'd simple be mean one. To him. I wasn't hoping you'd be mean to him. It takes an individual like yourself who is of a kinder heart more than 5 minutes to be mean to him. You would have to go into like your seventh minute before you find it in you, within you, to say, wait a minute, I should be mean to him.
Right. Now, from the entrepreneur perspective, and I've talked about this with a friend who developed he thinks he invented a sport. He says he invented a sport. Okay, developed a new sport 35 years ago. And I've had this conversation with him 100 times to the point where he won't talk to me anymore. But he's been on this same thing forever, trying to force what he believes is a good product down people's throats, where people have clearly made it clear, or clearly demonstrated, that they don't have any desire for this product. And I try to put it in these terms. You can't think about delivering to the world what you find valuable. You have to look at what the world wants and what they think is valuable, and then present a product or service that that adds value according to what they say their needs are, not what you want them to have. Do you agree with that?
Oh, yeah, that is absolutely correct. And it's exactly that idea of adjust self to situation, not the other way around. You may think in your mind you have the world's greatest product, but if nobody's buying it, something's wrong. And if you're not paying attention to that, then you're likely to fail.
Well, if I could, part of it is excuse making. I've got a product, nobody's buying it. It's not that there's something wrong there. It must be the marketing. It must be I got to fire my salesman. It's whatever. It never comes down to, am I really adding value to people's lives with what I'm offering? It's like the excuse making. So excuse making, I think, is part of a mindset as well. And I just want, if you are conditioned, you've conditioned yourself from a life of excuse making, I can't be wrong about this. How do you make that shift from being really focused on adding value to getting away from like excuse making about what that really is and taking a real honest look at what you're offering the world?
Yeah, that's a great question. So to be honest with you, I mean, shameless self-promotion, I think most people need to talk to somebody like me, because it's really difficult if you don't have the training to break through and see where you're causing problems for yourself. And when we talk to people like our friends or our family, we tend to get defensive because there's a lot of emotions wrapped up in those relationships. So if you get an objective outside person who can challenge you and say, here's what I'm hearing you say over and over again, it's excuse after excuse after excuse. That's fine. If you want to live with those excuses, that's fine, but the outcome is going to be the same. So here's an idea. Challenge yourself to make a change and see what happens. Because you're right. We fall into these patterns, and everybody has them. We want to feel good about ourselves. So we do a lot of things. We manipulate the situation. And in the case of business, maybe it is marketing. But then you try and change the marketing and you collect the feedback that says, oh, it's still a failure. And so you have to be willing to pay attention to the information that you're collecting from what's happening in the world around you and utilize that. And a lot of times we need some additional help. We need some training to be able to do that for ourselves more effectively.
Yeah, adjustments. I am more currently working with a woman I worked with many years ago. She's the CEO of a hairstyling education company. And she's ventured into YouTube, and a week or 2 weeks into it, not seeing results. And she's, well, you think this is going to work? She's already in, like, it's not working. I was like, YouTube, well, all the experts out there who talk about all the changes in YouTube and how to really make a difference in that. At the end of the day, it comes down to trial and error. You put something out there. You can A-B test. If you want to think, well, we got two separate strategies, put out this and this one, measure them about their results, see which one does better, go with the one that does better, then make adjustments on that. It's a constant adjustment phase. But a lot of people, you know, we live in a very short-term, immediate gratification type of society where if something doesn't work today, I'm ready to give up on it completely. And so that's part of mindset too is... And this is the challenge, and this is what I would like you to address, is the challenge of patience to keep with something and make those adjustments versus knowing when it really truly is time to say, this isn't going to work.
Yeah, so you're raising a couple of really great points. The first thing is I absolutely agree with you that people are oriented towards short-termism. I want an immediate fix right now. And I think you mentioned like life hacks earlier. I've written several times on my blog, there is no hack in life. Anything of value in life requires hard work, and it requires time to get to the valued endpoint. If you don't understand that, then your life is going to be way less fulfilling than it otherwise would be. So if you don't adjust your mindset first and foremost to valuing challenge, valuing the long-term commitment, then you're selling yourself short. So that's the first key piece. And the second thing that you were talking about is, you know, we can dump a lot of time, effort, and energy into something. And this, I oftentimes work with people in relationships. So it's like, I'm putting a lot of effort into this relationship. It's not really turning out the way that I wanted to. How do I know whether it's worth continuing to put in effort versus pull the plug? And the short answer is there is no easy way to kind of decide that. You have to look for you. And what I always tell my clients is, are you getting more out of this? Like, is this something that's a net gain for you, or is it a net loss? If you're continuing to operate at a net loss, then it probably is time to get out. If you made the changes, if you put in the effort, and relationships are harder than other things because you obviously have another person who you care about, who has their own probably journey where they're making changes and everything else. But the idea is you want to be constantly putting effort into things that are going to produce some kind of gain for you. And so having conversations with other people where you can talk about what are the pros, what are the cons, what's the amount of effort versus what am I getting out of it, that can help you make those types of decisions. Nobody can answer that for you. And the thing is, you might make the wrong decision, right? Lots of times people are like, I left this relationship, I want to get back into it, I gave up on this endeavor. Oh my gosh, the next week, somebody that was doing the same thing hit it big. You're not always going to win. But you have to be willing to constantly evaluate where you are, what you're getting, so that you can work to make decisions that are going to help you to feel better about the place that you're in.
Can't help but see myself in all of that. I gave up on podcasting in 2004. We were dabbling in podcasting, and I was like, this is never going to work. This will not. And now here we are 20 years later, and everybody and their brother has a podcast. But there's a lot of money and a lot of value in the industry. It's way overdone because everybody and his brother does have one. But I can't help but see myself in all those kind of things, thinking, well, it was a failed endeavor. Maybe I was ahead of the curve and all that kind of stuff. But still, what was the strategy that failed then that we can adjust now for the time now? So it's all.
My strategy was, I failed because I was born poor and I ran out of money. The ventures that I started back then, I had good ideas and I can see them being out there being done. But back in the 90s, I told you about my friend, my bass player, we made our own our portable spotlights with the foot switches so that we, because we didn't have that. We made a lot of things because we, out of necessity, which we had no, you know, if we had money, sure, we could have patented and stuff like that, or the wherewithal to think that somebody else would want to buy it.
Right. But again, now this comes down to my mindset, I think. Now, I don't want to get overly emphasized on this, but I think there was a limited belief system there that you needed to be the you needed all the cash to do this on yourself. There are angel investors. There are people you could pitch those. If you have a good idea that adds value to society and it truly does and you're sure of that, I think there are people that fund anything.
In the 1980s, and I was in my 20s, I had no concept.
Yeah, of course. Okay.
Yeah, that was like,
But, yeah, now there's an app that you could probably go to, but back then you
were. Right. Yeah, 1980s and 1990s, it was like, no, there was no app.
Interesting. And I wanted to ask you, and I'm going to ask you after this, about working with creatives. But since you mentioned working with relationships, we had a guest on earlier this week, and she's coming back in February. She's a psychic medium, but her book is about relationships. All's fair in love and karma. And it comes from a new age spiritual perspective of reincarnation and all this stuff. And that, because, you know, people are in a failed relationship and want to know when it's time to get out. All's fair in love and karma, or just the title, suggests that you deserve to be in a bad relationship if you're in a relationship, and that limited belief. And there are a lot of people who would buy into that and thinking, and again, I think she has the same publicist as you. So my intent is not to bash her, just to get a different perspective on this idea that you deserve. We create everything that that come our way in life. And if you're in that kind of relationship, that you deserve to be in it because you were meant to learn a lesson from it. Do you have any?
Yeah, I don't think she means deserves. I think she was saying you chose it as opposed to deserve it. I'm just saying, because I think it sounds a little, deserve sounds like if you're in an abusive relationship, you earned it.
All fair in karma, love and karma. Karma is what you've created for yourself. If you want to use that word, chose it.
Well, I'm just trying to perhaps give her the benefit of the doubt.
I just want to get Rebecca's comment on that.
Sure. So a couple of things that you mentioned. One thing that I wholeheartedly agree is, like, use every opportunity as a learning experience. So, like, I've been in some real bad relationships. And when I got out of them, it's like everyone's encouraging you, like, oh, that person's, you know, a piece of crap, whatever. And I thought to myself, like, no, I did make choices that put me in that relationship. I stayed in that relationship for X amount of time. What does that tell me about me and what I need to do to work on myself so that that doesn't happen again? And, like, one of the things I realized a while ago is I love an experience. So sometimes I, like, intersect with people that are not great for me only because they're interesting. And it, like, it adds value, it's entertainment. But in the end, it's going to end up hurting you. So now that I know that about myself, because I took the time to reflect on the choices I made that put me in that situation, instead of wasting time thinking about all the things that this evil person did to me, I can grow from that. So in that respect, I do agree with that idea. Of course, nobody deserves to be in a bad relationship, but we all make choices that put us into the positions that we're in. And life just happens, right? I wrote a blog piece a couple of months ago about life is unfair. Get over it. It's a fundamental aspect of the reality of life. It's not fair. Some of us are born with a lot more than others of us. Some of us have access to money. Some of us are better looking. Some of us are smarter. Some of us are funnier. Some of us have, like, yeah, I'm talking to you, exactly. So it's like you have a certain set of gifts and you have some disadvantages. That is the reality. So when I say, like, your choices put you where you are, they do, plus what's happening around you. But given that you can't control everything that's happening around you and you can control yourself, the onus is on you to always reflect on, what did I do to put myself in this situation? And what do I do to make sure that if I don't like it, it doesn't happen again? Or if I do like it, it keeps going.
Cool enough. How important is the semantics of this? Because GD did choose to reframe what I said as deserve into you chose this. And the semantics play into your mindset about how you look at a situation. How important is that in your view, to kind of reframe the acts, just a word, change a word about how you look at something? Is that?
I think it's huge. That's a huge part of mindset, is the way that you frame something matters, right? Because if I frame a challenge as something that's stressful, something that's going to be difficult for me, and I focus on the stress and the difficulty, I'm not going to have a lot of motivation to get over it. But if I look at the challenge as something that's going to push me, that help me grow, that's going to help me get stronger, now I am going to be motivated to get over it. So the way that you frame it is huge. Like, a core part of what I do with clients is mindset reframing. How are you thinking about things now? How can you think about things to be more powerful and help push yourself to engage in the behaviors that are going to help optimize your outcomes?
Interesting that you just in that answer, you're framing it as a challenge rather than a problem. And the last company I worked for before I retired, I went to the CEO of the company and said, you have a culture problem in this company, that everybody here is focused on identifying problems and calling them problems, and nobody is focused on identifying solutions and how to deal with those problems. So we have a complete culture of looking for problems. And if that's what you you train yourself to look for, it's like anything. You look for the color blue, you're going to see it everywhere. You look for problems, you're going to find them everywhere. If you look for solutions, you're more likely to find solutions. If you could talk about that, because you just in that simple reframing from a problem to a challenge, I think there is power.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and what you're describing is honestly a lot of what's happening in society at large. Everybody's looking for the problem. Everybody's trying to be the victim. Everybody's looking for the world owes me this, that, or the other. World doesn't owe you shit, right? It's like you are responsible for putting in the effort to get the things that you want out of life. And if you're oriented towards looking for a way to take advantage by pretending to be a victim, woe is me, this, that, and the other, you're disempowering yourself because you're basically saying, like, I'm not going to do the things that I need to do. I expect the world to do them for me. And the odds of that happening for you are slim to none. So you're going to stay in that space of just you want to stay a victim, go ahead, stay a victim. But your life is not going to be nearly as valuable as it otherwise could be for you in terms of getting fulfilling experiences if you're not willing to put in the effort. And absolutely, if you're going to complain, this is what I always tell people, like, if you're going to complain, that's fine. Complain. I call my business Vent to Reinvent, because part of it is like, complain, what's bothering you? Let's talk about it. But if you sit there in that space, if you don't reinvent, you're stuck. So if you're going to complain about something, you better be damn ready to figure out what's going to be the solution, or at least what can I try? Because we don't always know that what we think is going to work is going to work, but you have to be willing to try. Otherwise, you sit there and you give up in your victimhood, and that's not good for anybody.
Right.
I didn't want to turn this into politics, but it just so happens that one of the biggest victims in the public zeitgeist is Donald Trump. And I'm just saying, I'm not saying he's an actual victim, but that is what he does. He claims
victim mentality. Yeah,
you're coming at me. That they're coming at me, and they're coming at you through me. But it's working for him, at least in the sense that he's getting apparently what he wants, which is attention. And he's trying to stay out of jail, and so far he's been able to do that. So victimhood has been working very well for him as a business model. So what is it about him that makes victimhood work for him, but his followers who are also claiming victimhood, they're still just as poor as they were a few years ago.
I think he has some, let's call them skills at manipulation that some people don't have, right? There's, for better or worse, there's a certain type of charisma in the way that he presents things. And so he also has or had a lot of money, right? Depending on what version of his tax returns you believe. So he's in a position to garner attention. Not everybody that feels the same way or wants to utilize their victimhood has a platform to speak to millions of Americans on a regular basis. So that's part of what's going on. But we've also, as a society, cultivated this idea that the victim should be celebrated. And that, to me, is really damaging, because what that does is it reinforces people to want to be the victim because you're going to get stuff out of it. We need to go back to valuing people that are struggling and trying to be successful, not the person who's going to fall into their victimhood. It's the person that's working to overcome is the person that we should be celebrating, putting in the effort.
We don't celebrate all victims, because if you look at the people who came back from war, we didn't treat our veterans very well. And as a general rule of thumb, when women are subjected to rape, we didn't treat them very well either, historically.
Oh, right. Yeah, historically. But what I'm saying now, like right now, there's no better time for you to claim that something happened to you, because it will almost invariably get you out of something.
Well, this is a perfect segue here to where
I'm a blackness. I'm claiming it right now.
Yeah, of course. Of course you are. It always comes down to race with you. Perfect segue, because you work with entrepreneurs and individuals, but we're talking about cultures here, and a bigger thing of our culture of victimhood within organizations and stuff. Do you work with organizations on, first of all, identifying what their culture is? Because what you're speaking about is a culture of victimhood, and we can take that down to the individual level, but if we develop that as a culture, then it becomes infectious. So within what you do, do you work with organizations, or is it always on the entrepreneur level or individual level versus the organizational level?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I have programming available for corporations because the core of what I see as problematic in a lot of organizations is twofold. One, they like you're saying, they don't cultivate a culture that promotes what there's this term psychological safety. A lot of psychological terms I don't really like, but the idea is like you want to create a culture that promotes the endorsement and valuation of certain types of behaviors that are going to increase productivity, increase good employee relations, et cetera, et cetera. But the side part of that is we have a lot of employees that are coming from the younger and younger generations that are being told that their feelings are paramount in every situation. And so I always argue we need a new separation of public and private. Your feelings, your emotions, and everything, that should mostly be private. You worry about that, your friends worry about that, your partner worries about that, your family worries about that. At work, that should not be the thing that's paramount, but we're leading with like the individual. I wrote this article, don't bring your whole self to work, bring the part of you to work that I'm paying you for, which is the good part of you. All the other stuff that you're dealing with, keep it at home. That's not part of the workplace, but we've let it become part of the workplace because HR has like cultivated this mental health narrative that pervades everything that's damaging. And so the thing that I see that we need to also start doing is teach employees what your responsibility is at work and what your employer's responsibility is to you. And it's not to make you feel good all of the time. Sometimes it's like, you know what, dude, you're gonna have to stay a little bit late because you didn't get what you needed to get done because you weren't working as hard or as fast or whatever. You have to stay late. I'm sorry. And if that makes you upset as an employee, then you're not really understanding your role within the organization because you're having a me first, which doesn't work in an organization.
Toughest thing about being in, and everybody wants power in an organization, you know, prestige or whatever it comes with, position. But the toughest thing about having a position of responsibility is sometimes you have to accept the role of being a bad guy.
Right, right.
Not everybody's going to like you all the time. And no matter how much you try to cultivate a team mentality of we're all in this together, there are going to be some times where people who are subordinate to you in an organization are not going to be happy with you and probably curse you under their breath and go home and tell their spouse what an asshole you are.
And then the spouse would agree.
Also, I'm a professor, so I always tell my students on the first day of class, you know, like, I'm happy that you're here and I like you and I'm here to support you in your success in this class, but like you're probably not always going to like me because my job is to push you. And if you like this class, if you enjoy everything all the time, if you want me to be your best friend, it's the wrong space. I'm failing to do my job because in order for you to grow, you have to be pushed.
That is the psychological trigger that bothers me about coaches, because I know that's a coach's job, but I don't want the tough guy. I just want somebody who's going to be I want more of a cheerleader than a coach in my life.
But you can combine both of them. I mean, I think like good coaches can sense the person's personality and adopt a strategy that's going to speak to them more effectively.
By nature, I am more of when somebody presents to me with, what do you think about this idea? I take the position of coach rather than cheerleader right away. I an instant like that yesterday when somebody, what do you think about this idea? And I immediately went to the analysis of why I thought it needed some tweaking rather than saying, yeah, go, that kind of stuff. And I... That's just my nature. Now, we are running short on time here. And I have to say goodbye to Gov's Comedy Club, by the way. Gov, thank you for being here this morning. We'll see you Monday. It's always great to have Gov's in our back pocket. Creatives, do you work with creatives at all? Have you? Because we're living in a culture, whether automation and things have contributed to this, but more and more people really don't want to be employees in a company. They want to be entrepreneurs. They want to be creatives. They want to be self-employed, whatever that is. Do you work with those people at all?
Yeah, I do. So I've spent a lot of time working with people that are trying to start their own businesses, entrepreneurs in space, being creative. Absolutely. I think you're right. There are lots of people devalue the work that's towards the group and it's more about me. We see a lot of, you know, these like success stories of people that started a company and now they're millionaires before they're 30. The odds of that happening, of you being successful, that are small. So I usually recommend that people have multiple things going on, right? Like I'm a professor, I do the coaching, I also write fiction. So it's like, I have a lot of my hands in a lot of different pots. So that way, if one thing's not working as well, you've got something else to cover your back. You've got to be willing to hustle if you're going to be somebody that's going to be in the entrepreneurial creative space. And a lot of people that want to go into that space want to go into it because they don't have the hustle. They want to do a small amount of work, hit it big. That is never going to be a successful strategy for you. So I work with people to kind of identify what are their strengths, what are their values, and how can they do things that are going to allow them to be successful while being true to that, but also being realistic about the way that the world functions.
All right. Let me ask you this, because it might not be something you're used to addressing, but this idea of cultures, again, coming back to how people don't are turning away from that idea of being a 9-to-5. I think a lot of companies fell into this trap of dehumanizing people or making them feel insignificant. The cubicle culture, where you're in this box, you're like just a mouse or a rodent in a little, and basically this is your cubicle. You're a nobody. You're just another nameless, faceless box in our endless sea of boxes. That mindset in companies versus companies that have this very innovative, I'm going to use the word liberal, but not in a political sense, idea of how a company should be, open ideas that anybody can bring ideas to the CEO at any time, and we make it more like an enjoyable experience to come to work. Do you think that culture is changing in America? And certainly, I think you would agree that culture of cubicleism and making people feel like a nobody has contributed to this idea of, I don't want to work for a company, I want to work for myself. Just if you could comment.
Yeah, I agree with everything that you're saying, but there definitely has been a shift in terms of companies caring more about their employees than they did in the past. One of the things that I see, and this applies in multiple arenas, is people currently, like young people currently, are fighting against a situation that doesn't exist. They're fighting against the situation that they learned existed from their professors who are talking about something that existed 10, 20 years ago. So realistically, if you're getting hired now by most companies, your work experience is going to be way better than what it was 20 years ago. We've already done a lot of work. It doesn't mean every organization is perfect, and there's not more room for things to grow. But I think, again, the problem is if you're hired with the expectation that work is going to be fun for me and it's not actually going to be work, that's a problem for you, because when you're actually asked to do work, you just want to have fun. So there needs to be a balance in terms of recognizing that when I go into the office, I'm expected to do work. Yeah, I don't have to work in this, horrible white cubicle like in the movie Office Space, right? But you also need to recognize that some of what you're going to be doing is not going to be all fun and games, take time off to go play foosball or whatever, like a lot of companies have now. So there needs to be a balance, and that recognition needs to come from the employee as well as from the employer.
That's fair enough, because, I've been really retired from the corporate and business world for 8 years now. So and that's enough for the enough time for there to be a dramatic shift in the way cultures of businesses are. So I'm probably guilty of that thinking, I'm thinking about the way things used to be rather than the way they are today. So yeah, I appreciate all that. Vent to reinvent.com. The part of venting, I'm gonna get in trouble for that. I have to say this kind of low. My wife is listening. Venting to me, because my wife comes home all the time, she says, I'm not complaining, I'm just venting, and I'm supposed to sit there and be quiet and just listen. Explain to me the title Vent to Reinvent, because venting to me feels like a negative thing. Like, to me, that means I'm just going to have to sit here and just suck up a bunch of complaints and just be quiet about it and take it. Why the name Vent to Reinvent? Yeah, so,
well, because you're stopping at the vent part, right? It's the whole thing, vent to reinvent. So
but you want absolutely me to reinvent.
You absolutely can complain, right? Everybody needs to get stuff off of their chest. You have to, right? You, otherwise it just sits there, it bottles up inside. So the idea is, though, if you are going to vent, if you are going to complain, like we were talking about earlier, then you have to take the next step to reinvent. Why am I complaining? What is the issue that I'm seeing? Is there something I can do about it? And if there is, I need to be willing to take the step to do it, because I'm trying to get better. I'm trying to reinvent. I'm trying to optimize. I'm trying to push myself forward.
Okay. I appreciate you being here. Now, venttoreinvent.com. It's in the description. It's scrolling across there for people on the radio side. Venttoreinvent, all one word, .com. Now, what do people expect to see when they get there?
So the website has just some basic information about the general tone of my coaching, what I offer, and then I've got a lot of links to the articles that I've written and some of my blogs and talks that I've given, so you could learn a little bit more about me. And then there's also an opportunity to connect, so you can sign up with your email and set up an appointment to meet with me as well.
Okay. Now, what I've seen, and I don't know how I saw this, I think it was on YouTube, was like a mass Zoom call. It seemed like 100 people, and doing it. Is that a typical thing that you offer? To me, I would be intimidated by that. I want to put that out there. 100 people. I would prefer one-on-one or that kind of stuff. Is that typically how you work with people?
No. Mostly what I do is one-on-one. Individual appointments, but you know, like I said, I'm a professor, so I'm used to large groups, but no, most of the work that I'm doing with people is one-on-one, because I think that gives me the best opportunity to understand your unique situation, your unique set of strengths and challenges, and then help you to work to overcome that.
That feels safer, and I appreciate you clarifying that, because that definitely, if I were to be in need of your services, I would definitely prefer not have to make myself naked in front of a room
that
full
is
of
not
100
a requirement.
People. I make myself naked here every morning. I'm going to let you go, but there's a question in here. I don't know if you really want to handle this, but I'd like to give the chat room a chance to kind of.
Okay.
It said free will doesn't exist. Does that play into that mindset?
Okay, so whoever submitted that, love you. I've spent a lot of time actually learning about the way that philosophers view free will. At a philosophical level, the idea of free will is very difficult to defend. However, from a psychological perspective, there's research that demonstrates that if you believe in free will, whether or not it actually is a thing that exists, you will get better outcomes. So I choose to operate with the mindset as if free will is a thing. So right? Like it's there's what you believe at the core, and then there's what you believe that makes you to be functional.
Right. I am definitely supportive of the idea of if it works for you, use it. And that sounds a little bit like what you're saying there.
Yeah, for sure.
Dr. Rebekah Wanic, I appreciate you being here this morning.
Thank you so much for having me. It was a great opportunity.
If you come back, if and when you come back, or when and if, we can discuss the difference between an excuse and an explanation.
Okay, fabulous.
Have a great day, and thanks for being here. And
thank you.
Bye for now. You know, when you scratch your head, something happened with your mic. You got like really loud. That was try that again. Scratch your head and talk. Talk.
I don't know.
You're normal now. But you got like really booming.
Okay. I'll have to watch that. You know what it is? I grab the it depends on which hair I grab. One is for volume, one is for tone.
Very cool.
I grabbed the wrong hair.
Now you have a direct line to the Rev again this week. Tell the Rev, I would appreciate a description before I make the bucket, so I can don't just write. I don't know. I know he said something about sex and
voting. Yes, sex and voting.
Sex and voting.
Yeah. I'll have him write it out in detail, because it's actually a very, very thoughtful thing about sex and
voting. Now, I thought there were only 5 sermons, and they were just going to rotate.
No, there's like.
I got that from him. He said that.
I think he's talking about the average minister only has like 5 or 6 sermons, and they just tweak it a little depending on the holiday or whatever's happening in the news or you know, but yeah, but that's assuming those are people who write sermons. The Reverend doesn't really write sermons. He writes down like one or two sentences as concepts, and then his brain goes into like a stream of consciousness.
So sex and voting, two things you must be 18 years old to engage in. That's all I got on that. Sex and voting. I don't see any other link. I'm just trying to pick
them down. Oh, then you will definitely love to sleep through this one.
Oh. let me see the back. PBM TV, still nothing from anybody on PBM TV. Getting a lot of requests. I do have some musicians coming on in the near future and reaching out to some people who I've reached out to in the past who were peaking in their musical career 3 or 4 years ago, who gave me a no, but I'm going to reach back now as their careers have kind of leveled off or even gone down a little bit as in terms of being in demand. They might be more inclined to come on a show like this now that, you're not on top of the mountain anymore. Now you'll talk to me. What?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
You give them a call.
Yeah. John Rulo, who is a friend, will be on in I think 2 weeks, not next week, the week after next. But he's a friend, a local musician, singer-songwriter, who I've known for about 20 years. I'm really looking forward to that conversation. John is a guy who's played drums in the band, but he's not a drummer. He's a guitarist and singer, not a drummer first and foremost. But it will be a really interesting conversation. Look forward to that. Tomorrow night, I'm going to be at the Long Island Music Hall of Fame and Music and Entertainment Hall of Fame. It used to be just the Music Hall of Fame. For Jackie Martling's screening of Joke Man, which I've already seen and know the movie. So I'm probably going to be snoring. Oh, listen, I'm going to be sitting in a theater-like seat watching a movie I've already seen at least twice, probably three times. But I'm going with a friend, and there's a Q&A after, and he's excited about meeting Jackie Martling. So going to put through that. But I might end up going in the crowd a little bit.
Speaking of screenings, there's 10 movies that are being nominated for Oscars, like Best Picture. How many of them have you seen? Do you know?
Zero.
Oh, okay. That many.
Yes. I don't see movies. I was telling a friend last night, I have not been to a movie theater in probably 15 years. I can't remember the last movie I went to a movie theater for.
But you're going to a movie theater to see this, for see Jackie?
No, it's not a movie theater. It's the Long Island Music and Entertainment Hall of Fame. It's basically like the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. There's exhibits and stuff, but there's a big ballroom they have for speaking, and they're going to be projecting it on the big screen and all that. Okay. So it will be like a movie theater, but not necessarily a movie theater. Okay. But no,
so
I have.
So your streak is intact then. Your 15-year streak is intact.
Yeah, and I don't even see the first run movies at all in streaming. If I see a movie for the first time, it's generally a movie that is 20 years old already, and somebody actually finally talked me into checking it out. And by the time I get to it, it's already a classic or thought of as a classic.
So any day now, you're probably going to watch Godfather 5.
What about 4? You skipped right over 4.
There was I thought you had already seen 4.
There's no 4.
Okay, I don't know. Look, there are 9 Rockies, 9 Fast and Furious.
3 Godfathers, and most people think that they should have stopped at 2. I have watched 3.
There was a Godfather. I saw something. Maybe it's not considered a Godfather movie, but
The Offer. You're thinking of The Offer?
I don't know.
The Offer is about the Godfather saga. It was based on a book by Al Ruddy, who was the producer of the first Godfather. It's like a 10-part, 10-movie thing for Paramount Network or something like that.
Okay.
A serial thing. But it's backstage, the behind the scenes of the Godfather, how it came to be and all that kind of stuff. But no, there's 3 Godfathers. I saw Godfather 3 the day it came out, Christmas Day 1987 or something like that. maybe 88, and went to the movie theater to see that when it came out and thought it sucked, and then watched it about 3 years ago on streaming service somewhere. And I thought, well, maybe I judged it too harshly the first time. I was judging it against the first two. Not that bad if you take it by itself, 20 years removed or 30 years removed, 35 years removed, whatever, almost 40 years removed now. Yeah, it's not as bad as I thought it was. But I don't think they should make another. There should be no Godfather 4. Let it stop there. Let it die. Lastly, Jackie is taping an episode of World Record Podcast with Brendan Walsh today. I am extremely nervous about that because it's a blind date that I set up. But again, Brendan is so fucking crazy that I don't.
Are they doing this in the flesh or are they doing it Zoom?
They record it and then they edit it, so it won't be out till next Wednesday.
But I mean, are they sitting in the same room physically?
No, it's Zoom. Brendan's in LA and Jackie's here.
Okay, well, at least there's that buffer. As opposed to them being stuck in the same room.
Yeah, well, at least they're not going to punch each other, yeah. I just feel bad if I set it up and it goes bad that two of my friends are going to be angry at me for something that I had the best of intentions for. I'm nervous about it. I want them to get along. The only problem I have with it is Jackie was insisting on going in cold, like not knowing. He, just like with Bert Kreischer, he doesn't know anything about Brendan Walsh other than I said, yeah, he's a really funny guy and he's nuts. So he's going to go in there, and Brendan is fucking certifiably crazy. And if you don't know that going in, if you're not prepared, it could put you on the defensive. It could put you like, what the fuck is with this guy
you have to kind of like research it, because your idea of funny and nuts may not be my idea of funny and nuts. And so I'll go in thinking, looking for my funny and nuts, but it's not my funny and nuts. It's your funny and nuts. And then I'll be like, totally.
Well, let me give you some idea of what I think Brendan is capable of funniness. He did this thing as George Washington, where he dresses up like George Washington and does a Q&A live on YouTube. And when people ask questions that generally are typical questions you'd want to know about George Washington, he can react like angry and scream at people and ban them and like, yeah, and it's like intimidating. Like George Washington is now yelling at me like a madman. All I wanted to do was be honest, participate in this thing. And he does it in completely seriousness. Like he doesn't ever let people off the hook like you do, and never will say, I'm just kidding. So now you're like, man, I feel bad. This guy just fucking buried me. I was just trying to tune in and support his thing. That kind of thing is what I'm worried about happening. Like Jackie might not understand that that's who he is. He can make you feel like you're an idiot, but he's doing it as a joke, but not telling you he's doing it as a joke. That's, so
I can dig that. I can get that. Yeah.
So I'm worried about it. I'm worried about if it goes south, that I could lose two friends already.
is there a way that you can
they
can get you in the room that you can watch it like from the green room without being part of it?
Well, I could drive to Jackie's and watch it and be sit behind him. And
okay,
that's just Brendan. He's just nuts. He's just nuts.
Yeah, do that, and then you could probably pick up some pot too.
You know, that's, oh, did I tell you the other night? He said, you want some pot? I didn't tell you that, did I? That's interesting that you would say that, because he emailed me. I owe you. You want some pot? Ha ha! Hee hee! So, yeah, that's Jackie.
I should have followed him home and gotten some. It's only a 3.5-hour drive from where we were, which would mean a 6-hour drive from where I am now.
Yeah, actually, probably whatever Google's telling you about that, the distance is not the problem. It's the bridges and the traffic and all that kind of stuff. From Maryland to where he lives, even from where I live, even from the Long Island Expressway, which is the main road, to get up to his house, It's a fucking nightmare, man. It's a nightmare of small roads and bridges are closed and washed out, and it's almost impossible to get. He's well insulated. Jackie doesn't have to worry about the Civil War starting because it will never get to his neighborhood. He lives within a stone's throw from Theodore Roosevelt's old estate. He grew up down the block from it, but it's really hard to get there. Although it's not far from New York City. When I went to his place on the way to Sarah Talamosh's taping in Astoria, from his house to Astoria is probably only 10 miles. It took me almost 2 hours to get there.
Because of the little back roads and winding.
Yeah, all back roads. And just to get to the main road can take you 45 minutes just to get to the expressway, the main road to get there. Or you could take a road with lots of lights on it. There's a, you know, you could take a basic highway that has a light every block. A red light, stop, go one block, red light, stop. And so if you're going to New York City, mm-hmm. It starts at 265th Street, I think, in Queens, and then understand you're going to 4th Street in Queens. So every block, 261 streets of red light block, red light block, red light block.
Oh.
Yeah. Oh. That's the route I decided to take.
Up in the backwoods where he is, is flooding and the last snow that we had. Well, I don't know what y'all snow had. We wound up getting around 9 inches total.
Yeah, he lives right on the water. And there's a long bridge road that washes out a lot. So, yeah, that could be a problem getting to his. I don't think they got much snow where he lives. Where I live, it's different. We got 6 inches. I think he probably got an inch or so because he's Jackie. He's got a little inch.
Oh, okay. So who does your driveway? Do you do your own driveway? You have a plow, a snow thrower, or do you have little foreign helpers that come to your house to do your driveway?
There's the guy who looks like an old Groucho who's out there shoveling, and he looks like he's going to drop dead. He's got glasses and a mustache and a big nose like Groucho.
When the vultures see him out there, do the vultures gather? Because literally, I kid you not, every time when it's time for me to shovel or out there, vultures gather above my head. I could take video every single time of the vultures above my head when I'm shoveling snow.
We have turkeys, but they don't eat humans, so no, I don't have that. But I have a neighbor who has because everybody around here has 500-foot long driveways. And the neighbor who has a snowblower does everybody in the neighborhood's driveway except mine.
Why? Is yours gravel and he's afraid it'll break, or he just doesn't like you?
I think he doesn't like me. I think I wouldn't. Listen, I couldn't blame him. Who does like me? Nobody likes me. I'm unlikable.
Well, I kind of like ish. So I'm on the fence about liking you.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you're on the fence. You're safe. You're up. You're not going to get snowblowed up on this fence. So it's a good place to be. Anyway,
this way, if you needed help moving, I would consider it. I wouldn't just say yes right away.
Here's the deal. If I needed help moving further away from you, you'd be all in for it. If I needed help moving closer to you, you'd be like, fuck no, I ain't fucking dealing. I ain't helping. That's the way we like to look at it. That's a week for you, folks. We're wrapping up Friday. Have a great weekend. You two, I'm kicking you out of the room. Get out of my room. I kicked them right out in mid-sentence. How about that? I'm telling people, don't forget to turn on your radio. Oh, I just pressed the wrong button. Don't forget to turn on your radio and join us next week for more of this. Hopefully the Civil War won't start over the weekend or today, but you never know. Grab your rifles, grab your ammunition, praise the Lord and grab the ammunition. Have a great weekend. Don't forget to turn on your radio button now.
listen to me now.